the 10 characteristics of ideal leadership. Are we together? If you are together, jump up and shout amen. Amen. Jump up and shout amen. Amen. Jump up and shout Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. 10 characteristics. 10 characteristics of an ideal Christian leadership. Number one, it is leadership patterned after Christ. It is leadership patterned after Christ. Paul said in 1 Corinthians, Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Hebrews 12, 2, let your eyes be fixed on Jesus. Hebrews 3, 1, let your thoughts and concern be on Jesus. Praise God. It's a leadership that is patterned after Christ. Why? Christ is the greatest leader that ever lived. The greatest leader that ever lived. He didn't go to many countries, so as many leaders are touring countries, but his name has reached all countries. His influence is in all countries. They say he didn't write any book, but he has influenced, he's the subject of the greatest book ever written, the Bible. Praise God. Amen. He never built any house, never rode any car, but he's more famous than all leaders of the world combined. He is the greatest of all leaders. So leadership patterned after him is ideal. Number two, is a spirit-led leadership. Ideal Christian leadership is a spirit-led leadership, but it is dangerous. When you are running a spirit-led leadership and you are secretive, you are not carrying everybody along, because a spirit-led leadership is dynamic. It's not one way. Meaning, even as we are here now, the spirit can say, close. But if all of us are at tune with the spirit, we obey. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 15 verse 28, the apostle said, it has pleased the Holy Spirit and us. The apostles said, it has pleased the Holy Spirit and us to send you these directives. Acts of the Apostles chapter 15 verse 28. Meaning, we are walking in pari passu with the Holy Spirit. Number three, an ideal Christian leadership characteristic number three is, it is a kingdom-minded leadership. It is a kingdom-minded leadership. Evangelium Secundum Matthaeum, the gospel according to Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, it says, Quaerite primum regnum Dei. Seek you first, what? The kingdom of God, regnum Dei. Seek first the kingdom of God. John chapter 4, verse 34, downwards, Jesus said, my food, my meat, is to do the will of him that sent me. Ideal Christian leadership is the one that is kingdom-minded, building the kingdom of God, not just building mansions, not just about raising money. We cannot build without money. But your success is not about how much you handed over. You see, when we are handed over, in our account, we have 20 million. That is okay. Nobody saying money is bad. But seek you first means what is called priority. Someone say priority. Amen. How many members of your community understand the kingdom of God? Even among you here, how many of you know what the kingdom of God is? Because when I go to the kingdom now, it's God I don't even know. And you are a Christian and you are even a leader. Praise God. Amen. Right, it was in your dinner I came to teach us about the kingdom of God. And God, and even the teachers who teach others don't know what the kingdom of God is all about. That was what led me to write the school of the kingdom from your dinner. The kind of question they asked me, and the doctor requested I should give them the script I used to teach. I said, don't worry, I'll put it in a book. That was the origin of school of the kingdom. Teachers don't know, much less members. And almost everywhere I have gone to teach on the kingdom, people say, but we have been Christian for long and we didn't know this. I say, it's not your fault, because we all grew up from what they call the Christian religion. And almost everybody is having a religious mindset, not a kingdom mindset, because we believe that Christianity is a religion. It's not, I'm not saying it's your fault, but we are of age. You are of age. That's why we need to read. We need to make research. Praise God. You know, when we talk to people, sometimes when people think that when we tell people about buying books or things, they just want think we want to make money. Yes, who does not want to make money? But how much will the person make from you than the grace of knowledge that will be imparted in you? I had my Dr. Mike Mudok said one day that he was in a meeting and somebody preached. I thought he was impressed by the wisdom from the preacher. He sent his secretary to say, go to his table, pick everything he has one by one. I think it amounted to, I can't remember for sure, it's $1,500. But it's a big amount of money. He says, Christian, come and say, that is a very big amount of money. He does not want it. And he said, he replied to him, say, I am the one who needs what he has. I want it. Go and pay and pick everything he needs. He has. Today, if you talk of wisdom, the number one person that comes to your mind is Mike Mudok. Praise God. So, we need to make researches. Don't just be satisfied with building mansions. The Bible says the first thing is the kingdom. Many preachers tell us the world is about to end. Why? They talk about the signs of the end. Where did they get it from? Matthew chapter 24, one of the places. Jesus listed many things to show that the world, when would the world end? Rumors of war, famine, those are things happening. And so people go to and they say the world is about to end. But there's only one positive thing Jesus said in Matthew 24 about the end of time. All that things people talk about are negative. There's only one thing Jesus said is a positive thing, which if it doesn't happen, the world will not end. And that's why I keep saying the world will not end tomorrow. What's that positive thing? In verse 14, he says the preaching of this kingdom, the kingdom message, must be preached to all nations as a witness, else the world will not end. But everybody that wants to pray about the end of the world, we talk about all the negative things. They themselves don't even know the positive. 90% of Christians don't understand the kingdom of God and you want Jesus to return. Praise God. Knowledge is very important. Tell your neighbor, knowledge. Okay. Point number what? Number four characteristic. It is a leadership that is faithful. Open to Hebrews chapter 3. Leadership that is faithful. 1 Corinthians 4 talks about being faithful. Let's look at Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 2 and verse 6.
For he was faithful to God, who appointed him, just as Moses served faithfully when he was entrusted with God's entire house.
Mm-hmm. Verse 6.
But Christ, as the Son, is in charge of God's entire house.
Mm. The Bible said, from verse 1, where which we have read before, we should fix our eyes on Jesus, who is faithful in all of God's house, just as Moses was faithful. And say, Jesus is the Son over God's house, that we are that house. But Jesus is found to be faithful. A leader that should be an ideal one must be faithful. Must be faithful. Faithful as you handle money. Faithful as you deal with sisters, or as you deal with brothers, as you deal with the opposite sex. You know, there are a lot of things that happen today. What is the trend now? The lady that revealed, that before her pastor, their pastor will preach on Sunday, you must first of all sleep with her. And he said that that was what God said. So that miracle will be flowing. And it's not only her. But thank God one day she had a dream and Jesus appeared and something left her. Her eyes clear. She said, ah, this is what I've been doing. She was, it's on news now. Praise God. So there are a lot of things people do in the name of we are serving God. Which type of God we don't know. The type of God we don't know. The other one is the guy that was going around churches that they are being used as miracle. The one that said that he has something in hand. From the news I was writing that she was not even a Christian. And she said she didn't even know that what she was doing was wrong. All she was after was the money they used to pay her. People say, ah, God is here, God is here. Be faithful. God will not ask you how many souls did you heal if God did not say give you healing ministry. Hello? Be faithful. Understand your office and stand by it. Don't try to be big. Don't try to be high. Don't try to be him. Be faithful where you are called. You are a steward ministry. You are in steward ministry. And your duty is to clean bench for us. Be faithful in cleaning the bench. Forget about me that I'm the leader of the intercessory ministry. Once I lay on somebody, this person will fall. You want them to drop your rag so that you go and be laying hands on people. Is that where you are called? Do you understand me? That is it. Me that if I pray for people they fall, and I'm helping sister, and when she was singing, as she was singing, I'm going to be carrying people. I say, eh? What is God does she have that I don't have? Be faithful where you are. God will not judge you by how many people that fell down when you are singing, when God did not call you into singing. You only be judged based on the gift, the grace, the office you carry. And can you imagine the testimony? Using to number one, that Moses was faithful. Number two, that Jesus is faithful. And this Moses that the Bible gave us example of faithfulness did not enter the promised land because of unfaithfulness. That means he impressed God. He did wonderfully well, but he failed it on one account. And that one account was one too many. Because it was a spiritual mathematics he failed, not a physical one. If it was a physical one, he would have been forgiven. Praise God. It was a spiritual mathematics. Why? He had refused him. He was asked to talk to the rock. No, to smite the rock. And water came out. Now, that was Exodus 17. Numbers, what? Now 20. He was asked to speak to the rock. And Moses, I'm used to it, routine. Why did Moses not enter the promised land? What was his offense? What did he, what is it? The instruction was to talk to the rock, so that the rock would bring water. But he had was instructed before to hit the rock. So he hit the rock again, not knowing that that rock was Christ in the Old Testament. That is the Moses' offense. The first hitting stands for crucifixion. That was a spiritual arithmetic. But after crucifixion, before he gets anything, he has to do with prayer, talk. So Moses said he has to die another one. God said that is a spiritual error. He cannot die twice. Praise God. That is a spiritual error. And Moses paid for it, even though he had been found to be faithful. Once Jesus has been crucified, there is no other sacrifice that is needed. What is needed now is prayer. Talk to him. Prayer. And that's what people who don't understand, they are still performing sacrifice with pigeon, with the goat. That is making the same mistake of Moses. That one sacrifice is not enough. Tell anybody it's enough, it's enough, it's enough. All right, characteristic number five is a leadership that loves unto death. Leadership that loves unto death. I love you, I love you. I want to marry sister. Sister, I love you. You are the only sugar in my tea. Hello? What type of love? Any love that is not unto death does not qualify you as a husband. Hello?
Yes.
If you cannot die for your wife, you are not qualified to be a husband. You cannot represent Jesus well. And so for those who are not yet married, any lady you cannot die for, don't tell the lady I want to marry you because I love you. John 15:13. Greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his children. I love you. Hey, if I didn't see you 2 days, I will not sleep. If my body, as I see you now, is as my body is doing me. She accepts to marry me. I know her, past my mother, on her. Then after 2 years, no child. 5 years, no child. 7 years, no child. A brother told me, say, Mama Mumrumamunonyos. She wants to now divorce our sister because his mother gave birth to him, so he will also give birth to her. I asked him, do you know that? Because he's telling him that he wants to take permission to go and marry another one. I said, do you know whether that second wife you marry will also give birth? He said, oh, are you wishing? I said, no, I only asked the question, I'm not wishing anything. As I'm talking to you now, she has left that our sister. After over 10 years of marriage. Do you understand? So anybody who says I love you, I love you, like those of you, our single sisters, we don't have many sisters. I love you. It's not about marriage. Stop! Understand what the person means by love. Eh? Like some Protestants who say, for better, for worse, is no longer good. Just say, for better, for better. For better, for stay. For worse, for run. Point number 6. Hallelujah. It's a leadership that is patient. Someone say patient. Sometimes you have to be patient with your members because their understanding may not be at par with your own. Sometimes you have to be patient with other ESCO. Try to sell the vision to them. They may be slow in catching up, but be patient. Luke chapter 3 tells us that Jesus did not start his ministry until even when he was 30 good years. He was patient till that time, even though he knew what he came to do. Luke chapter 3 verse 13. He did not start it until when he was 30. We are rounding up. Number 7 now. Patient leadership that is dependent on divine leading. Dependent on divine leading. Meaning, before you put up any project, seek the face of God. Just know you are not a leader by yourself. You are supposed to lead with the owner. We may not have time to read again, but in John chapter 5, verse 19, Jesus said, I have no power of my own. I only do what I see my Father doing. I follow his footsteps. Follow the leading of God in all that you do. Leadership that is dependent on divine leading. John 5, 19. Number 8, characteristic number 8 is leadership that is transformational. Leadership that is transformational. What does that mean? It transforms you, it transforms your members. Meaning, after 4 years, will you still remain as you were? No. Will your members still remain as they were? No. If not, you have failed. In John chapter 14, verse 9, Jesus said, he who has seen me has seen the Father. Meaning, I am just like him. Guess what? All the apostles at the time began to resemble Jesus. They were transformed like Jesus, such that the Jews were now confused how to identify who is Jesus. So he had to take an insider, Judas, to say, the one I kiss, he is the one. If not, probably they would grab the Thomas to go and kiss. Because they started looking alike. Both spiritual and physical transformation. And so in John 18, when they came, John, who are you looking for? Say, they didn't say we are looking for you. They said we are looking for Jesus. He said, I'm the one. He had to introduce himself. In the midst of others, they are so relating that the transformation is both spiritual and even physical. They began to resemble, talking alike, behaving alike. Praise God. Say, I'm the one. You may not have time to read, but if you go to 2 Samuel chapter 23, from verse 8, 2 Samuel 23, it talks about
who?
It talks about the mighty men of valor of David. He began to list them. 2 Samuel chapter 23. How did they become mighty men of valor? You look at 1 Samuel chapter 22. 1 Samuel chapter 20 from verse 1 talked about the people that came to David. He said, these are people that were in debt, owing people. People that were distressed. People that were in pain. In fact, people that, if it is in today's world, should be thinking of going to commit suicide because life is not favoring them at all. Because when David ran out, they are the ones that went and met David in the desert, and David became their leader. These are the same people that David transformed, and we begin to hear about David's mighty men of valor. How are you going to lead the people that you met as their leader? After a leadership, how will they be spiritually? How will they be physically? How will they be psychologically? How will they be economically? How will they be academically? All-round transformation. That is why we don't only focus on spiritual programs. We do economic programs. We do academic programs. We do marital programs. Many people don't even know what marriage is. And many of us are married. And the family is the cell of society. So if you focus on family, you are transforming society. Many people don't understand what Christian marriage is. They think that marriage is all the same. How do we have a godly Christian home? We don't know. How should we marry in God's way? We don't know. We think that marriage is based on love. I love you, I love her. Marry. Mommy, I see why you're married. The first question is, does he love you? Because you don't, your mommy don't even know what marriage is all about. It's not about love. Praise God.
Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah.
Point number 9 is ideal Christian leadership is leadership that is accountable for souls. Accountable for souls. John 6:39, Jesus said, of all you gave me, I lost nothing. Someone say, I will lose no one. Is it in your leadership? Brother will go, open that church that way. Another brother will go, open church that way. Because of the way you handle them, you are losing your members. You are losing brother. You are losing sister. Because of their style of leadership. Just say, all you have given me, I have lost none. John 6:39. In John 17:21, when he was praying, he said, of all that you have given me, no one is lost except the one that chose to be lost, so that scripture will be fulfilled. If anybody is going to be lost in your leadership, let it not be that you push the person out. Let it be the person chose to go. Let it not be that you are the one who is pushing the people out. Sometimes some leaders persecute people because they have gifts. Praise God. You want your own voice to be heard. I don't want anybody to prove that he's more than me. You start persecuting the person. What are we dragging? All that you have given me, no one is lost. John chapter 17, verse 12. He says, except the one that chose to be lost. Finally, the ideal Christian leadership is leadership that is focused on service. Everyone say service. Leadership that is focused on service. So I will not explain it further because that was our text. Service. You are elected to serve. You are chosen to serve. You are a leader to serve. So everybody stand on your feet. Leadership that is patterned after service. What will I do? What will I give? Not what am I to get.